Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless his name. Amen. Just so you know, my wife did text me and said they just got called back. Mm-hmm. The doctor saw my daughter's foot. She responded by saying, "Oh, goodness." So, I don't know what that means. But that's all I got. Amen. Amen. As we come down to preaching and teaching from God's holy word, today's pericope will found once again in the book of Psalms. We continue on in the book of Psalms. Today is Psalm 90. Psalm 90. My wife asked me last, I think it was last night, she said, "I'm so sick of this book of Psalms." It's something else. I love it, but you've been preaching it all year. Today we only got a few more songs here. Then we'll get to something else. He said, "Don't take the wrong way now." I'm hoping we won't get to something else. But we have Psalm 90. Those of you who are able, we ask you to stand just one more time as we read into your hearing Psalm 90. There you will find these words written by Moses. And it says, "Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, wherever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, Return, ye children of men, for 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it passed. And as a watch in the night, thou carriest them away as a flood. They are as asleep in the morning. They are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourishes and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thy anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow. For it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger, even according to thy fear? So is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long? And let it repent thee concerning thy servants. O satisfy us early with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad according to the days wherein thou hast afflicted us, and the years wherein we have seen evil. Let thy work appear unto thy servants, and thy glory unto thy children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands establish thou it." God's word for God's people. It is blessed. And may that a blessing to us all. Eternal God, our Father, again, Lord, we thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for everything that has been said and done here in this service today. We thank you, Father God, for the songs of Zion that have been sung. We thank you for the prayers that have been lifted up. We thank you for the gifts that have been given unto you. But most of all, we thank you for that sweet, sweet spirit that is in this place, because it must be the spirit of the Lord. And so, Spirit of the living God, we pray now that you would fall down fresh and anew on each and every one of us. Anoint us, Father God, from the top of our head to the tips of our toes, so that we might be more like Jesus. And then, as always, Father God, your manservant, I pray now that you would hide me behind the cross, that only you might be seen. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to my mind and speak through these lips of clay, that I might give your word as you have given it unto me. And then, as always, Father God, I ask for preaching power, the kind of power that makes preaching easy. I ask all these things in your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let the church say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of our Lord. For the time that we have to share today, church, I want to put a tag on this familiar text that says, "Don't waste God's time."
Amen. Don't waste God's time. I only have a minute, 60 seconds in it. Forced upon me, I did not choose it, but I know I must use it. Give an account if I abuse it, suffer if I lose it. Only a little tiny minute, but eternity is wrapped up in it. These are the faithful words of Dr. Benjamin E. Mays, the former president of Morehouse College. He was there during the days of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and many of us heard these words when Elijah Cummings stepped to the microphone for the first time as an elected representative from the state of Maryland. And I want to say to you today, church, that these words, they are not ever grow old. These words, they should never become stale, and they should never ring hollow in the hearts of God's children. You see, because these words, church, they highlight something that's true for all of us, which is all of us are running out of time. That everybody in here, we all are suffering from one common condition. And the one common condition that all of us are suffering from is time is running out. And I don't know what none of us like to think about what the end is going to be, but the truth of the matter is about life, that every day that you live, you are just one day closer to die. The other fact about life is none of us, church, know when that day is. None of us know how much time we have left. I don't care what the doctor said, I don't care what the prognosis said. None of us know when the end is going to show up. What I do know, church, is life is like the sands through the hourglass. And so are the days of our lives. You see, because when life begins, the seconds turn into minutes, the minutes turn into the hours turn into days, the days turn into weeks, the weeks turn into months, the months turn into years, and before you know it, you ain't young anymore. Before you know it, if you're not careful, you'll find yourself thinking, where have the time gone? Come on, somebody say that to themselves, because no matter what you do in life, time does not wait on anyone. See, that's why Omar Khayyam wrote that the moving finger of right had been written, it moves on. And no, all your parties, no, all your wit may draw it back half a line. No, wash out one word of it. You don't get to go back and do anything over again. Time is the one thing that you cannot go back in. Again, that's why we all got to make the best use of the little bit of time that we have. You see, because God has numbered our days. And none of us have an infinite amount of time. So, church, as we turn our attention to our text, the Bible says that this is Psalm 90. But the truth of the matter is, this could be called Psalm 1. Because the truth of the matter is, this is the first psalm that was ever written. You see, this psalm was written by Moses at the end of the book of Deuteronomy, after the children of Israel had wandered for 40 years through the wilderness. Moses wrote this song because after wandering for 40 years, he realized how much time they had wasted. See, because God had brought them out of Egypt, God had carried them over the Red Sea, and the journey to the promised land should have took only a couple of days. Yet, because of their unbelief, a couple of days' journey turned into 40 years. Moses thought about their journey and thought about all the time that they had wasted. Moses cried out to God. All I'm trying to tell somebody is, don't ever confuse movement with progress. Come on, no, never confuse, because you're doing a lot of something that you're making progress. You see, because the children of Israel were constantly moving, they were constantly tearing up and putting down, they were constantly doing this and doing that, yet they weren't getting nowhere. All they were doing was keeping busy and ain't going nowhere. They weren't going nowhere and they were not doing what God had called them to do. And I don't care what it is that you're doing in life, you might be busy, but if you're not doing what God has called you to do, raise my kids telling them I am the bitch there. Just some of you that have never seen the movie before, this man, a black man, never had much, but he did have five daughters and raised his niece. And the only desire he had for them six girls was, I want all of y'all to be a doctor. He raised them to get good grades. He raised them to do everything in pursuit of life so they could go to college, and one day they could get a scribble scrabble around their neck. He had one daughter, just didn't want to do right. At least he obeyed her character. She didn't want to go to college. She didn't want to follow her daddy's rules. She didn't want to do it daddy's way. She wanted to do her own thing. Sad part of the movie was they were at her mother's funeral. She had finally got around to going to college and going to be a doctor. She came to her daddy, who had just lost his wife, and he was sitting there on the doorstep, and she said, Daddy, I want you to know that I'm finally going to medical school. His response was, he didn't have a party, didn't clap his hand, didn't give her a hug. Instead, he looked at her and said, yeah, what about all the time that you wasted? Well, a lot of us want to have a party, want to clap our hands, want to tell somebody what we've done, yet we still ain't got around to doing what God has called us to do. God ain't having no party because you're doing what you want to do. Instead, God is looking and saying, like the ditch digger, yeah, all the time that you wasted. So, church, I believe that in this context of this psalm right here, God teaches all of us about God to appreciate the time that God has given us. First thing that we got to know about God is we got to know about God's eternality. Moses starts this psalm by saying, Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Moses said, before you created the mountain, before you even created the earth and the world, Lord, from everlasting to everlasting, you've been there. What Moses was referencing here in church is that even while we were slaves in Egypt, we can still come to you, Lord. Even while we've been wandering around this wilderness for 40 years, the good news is we can always come to you. You see, because while we never had a place that we can call home, you are always there, so we have a place where we can rest our soul. You see, church, the good news about the God we serve is God didn't become their dwelling place when they were in Egypt. He didn't become their dwelling place when they were in the wilderness. No, Moses said, you've been our dwelling place for all generations. Moses said, you've been our dwelling place, Lord, from everlasting to everlasting. You see why that is, church? Is because the God we serve is eternal and everlasting. You see, the God that we serve is the God that always was. He is the God that is, and he's the God that always shall be. God that we serve, church, he is time. He existed before time. He endured time. He transcends time. He goes beyond time. And he knows all about time. So if there's anybody that can teach us how to appreciate the time that we have, it is God and God alone. See, the good news for all of us is that this eternal God, he's also omnipresent, which means that he is everywhere. Which means no matter what you, where you go, no matter what you do, whether you're on the mountaintop of all your joy or in the valley of all your despair, God will be right there. Not only will God be there, but God will be your refuge, and God said, I will be your dwelling place. Amen. God is eternal and everlasting. That's why we got to understand that we only here for what? A little while. But God, he always has been here, and he always will be here. The second thing we got to understand about God is we got to understand God's sovereignty. Down in verse 3, Moses says, thou turnest man to destruction, and saith ye, return, O children of men. Here, church, Moses is making reference to the fact that God is the one that created us, and not we ourselves. And because God is the one that created us, we need to understand that God, not cancer, not diabetes, not high blood pressure, God is the only one that can call you home. Genesis 2 and 7 said that the Lord God, he formed man from the dust of the ground, and he breathed into his nostril the breath of life, and man became a living soul. God calls his soul home. This old body goes back to the ground from whence it came. That's why one of the last things somebody will ever say over your body is dust to dust, because God has decided to call you home. What Moses is saying is God is the one that has authority. God has sovereignty over life and death. In order to highlight this, when you read this text, Moses talks about how quickly and how swiftly death can come. Moses wants us to know that, look, you got little control over when you were born and when you die. Moses uses three analogies here in the text to let us know how it is. He said to God, God is like a watch in the night. God comes forth and like a flood, you're carried away swiftly in the blink of an eye. Death can carry you away. He said, it's like sleeping in the morning. He said, it's like grass that's growing up, and all of a sudden, the grass is cut down. In other words, Moses is saying, what if you can be here today and go tomorrow? Not everybody in here is going to get a 2-week notice. Not everybody in here is going to have the doctor tell you, you got 30 days, so call your kids, call your family, call your friends, and say your final goodbye. Some of death is going to show up in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. And you won't be gone. And all that stuff you've been waiting to do, you've been planning to do, you've been hoping to do, it's going to be over. It's all going to be wasted time. See, when it comes to death, sometimes we like to say, people died too soon. We like to say, it was unexpected. I've never heard of an unexpected death. Everybody that's been born, you ought to be expecting to die. See, because the truth of the matter is, it might have been unexpected to us, but God knew all about it. See, because before the foundations of the world, before any of us were ever born, God in his sovereign power had already ordained how long we would be here. Psalm 139 reads this way in the New Living Translation. It says, you saw us, God, before I was born, and every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had even passed. In other words, the psalmist was saying, God knew you before you knew yourself. Mm-hmm. And God had already ordained how long you would live. And I ain't trying to knock nobody for what they want to do and how they want to live. But these folks out here trying to go to the gym every day and eat healthy and keto diet and all that. Tell me how that works out again. I never heard nobody find a diagnosis or a prescription for death. You might just be a healthy dead person. But eating right ain't gonna keep you here one day past the days God has already made for you to be here. It might improve your quality of life, but it is not going to increase your quantity of life. Mm-hmm. When it's time to go, you ain't got to be eating pork, you ain't got to eat no carbs, no sugars. Mm-hmm. When it's time to go, hey, buddy, it's time to go. I'm not trying to belittle it, I'm just being honest. God is sovereign. The next thing you got to know about God, and all of us got to know this, is about God's severity. Moses starts verse 7 by saying, for we are consumed by thy anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Moses said, yo, this ain't about the enemy. This ain't the man doing this to us. We're going through what we're going through because God. This was Moses' way of acknowledging, church, that they weren't just wandering through the wilderness for 40 years because they couldn't find the promised land. No, they were going through what they were going through because of God's wrath and because of God's anger. In order for this to make sense to you, you gotta understand this word consumed. Moses said, we're being consumed. What Moses is making reference to here is, listen, history tells us Moses did more funerals than any other preacher. Sometimes preachers get together, we talk about how many funerals we did last year. Ain't none of us did more funerals than Moses. You see, because God had promised them a land filled with milk and butter. Instead of believing that the same God that sent the 10 plagues, the same God that brought them out of Egypt, the same God that carried them over the Red Sea, the same God that had provided for all their needs, instead of believing that he could do what he said he would do, give them a land filled with milk and honey. Instead, they decided to murmur and to complain. And because of their disbelief, God said, ain't none of y'all worthy of receiving the promise. Now see, what God could have done was, God could have killed the law. God could have snapped his finger. And just like he took Pharaoh and his army out, he could have took all them out. Sometimes God has a funny sense of humor. Instead, God said, I'm going to let y'all keep walking around and dying one by one. I want y'all to remember what could have been. I want you to think about all the time that y'all have wasted. When Moses thought about church, what had happened to them, Moses said, we're being consumed. We're being eaten up. We're being picked off by God's anger and by God's wrath. Being church, that'll be a word for somebody in here, because listen, the God delivered. But when my grandma said do something, you didn't get around to it. You didn't do it when you felt like doing it. Because if you did, she had a way of motivating you. I know this ain't the way it is today, but she had a way of getting you to get a little pep in yourself. Because you couldn't do what you wanted to do when you got ready. Same way our earthly parents didn't allow that, God don't allow it either. When God said move, the only proper response is to go. Some of us wait for God to show us all the answers, to send all the resources, to fill in all the blanks before we do what God said do. God just says go. Again, when we disobey God, we run the risk of making God mad. We run the risk of kindling his anger. And I know when we come to church on Sunday morning, we don't only want to talk about the God we serve that is all-knowing, all-caring, all-giving, and all-loving, but we also got to be honest. The God we serve does get mad. He gets angry. He does punish us. And if you know God like I know God, you know his punishments, they can be long, they can be harsh, and they can be severe. See, because the Bible says God chases those that he loves. Be careful making God mad. Because you believe in grace and mercy following you all the days of your life. It does. But God's anger is something to deal with. But lastly, as he makes this final turn in the text, Moses tells us that we got to know something about God's mercy. He is a merciful God. See, because as he takes this final turn in the text, Moses says, teach us, Lord, to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. And hear me now, church. Moses is not telling anybody in here to go home and get your calculator out. Multiply how many years you've been living times 365. Divide your years by four and add one for each leap year. Calculate the months since your last birthday to your next birthday. gonna multiply that by 30 and come up with a total. And they come and well, I've been living 17,789 days. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That ain't impressing nobody. That's how long I've been living as of today. That ain't impressing nobody. See, God is not trying to tell you to physically number your days. What Moses is asking God to do is to help us appreciate the days that we have. You see, nobody knows how many days God has ordained for them. Nobody knows how many days they have been allotted in life. But God does. God knows when you're just one day away from the last day. Great John Edwards, in the 70 propositions of life, one of them was, I think number 6, he said, live every day as if today was your last day. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's how you appreciate the time that God has given you. Because the truth of the matter is, you don't know if today is your last day. Mm-hmm. What Moses was trying to say is, Lord, we tried to do it on our own. We tried to do it without you, but we failed in the past, we're failing right now, and we're going to keep on failing. That's why we need you, Lord, to help us in ways that only you can. You see, here's what Moses realized, church. Moses realized that God hated sin more than he loved them. And he realized that because of their own sin, they had become separated from God. And what Moses was pleading with God is, Lord, return to. In other words, he said, Lord, I know we're not worthy. I know we don't deserve another chance. I know we're not worthy of being in relationship with a God like you. But so, Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, return to us while we still have time. And I want to tell you, church, that this ought to be the cry and the plea for every one of us in here today. Because who among us can say we've never procrastinated? Who among us can say we never wasted any of God's time? Who among us can say that we didn't put off till tomorrow what we should have done today? Who among us can say that we never sinned against our God? You see, if you never wasted any of God's time, if you never sinned against God, then you ought to be asking God what Moses asked him in verse 14, which was, satisfy us early with thy mercy. Every day you wake up, you ought to ask God to have mercy on you. Lord, you said the wages of sin is death. And I'm not dead yet. After all the stuff I've done, Lord, I'm still here. After all the sins I've committed, Lord, I'm still here. So I need you, Lord, to have mercy on me. Lord, help me to rejoice and be glad in our days. Make us glad, Lord, according to the days wherewith you have afflicted us and the years wherein we shall see you. Mm-hmm. What Moses was saying is that no matter where you are, no matter where you go, evil is always present. Mm-hmm. Now, even in church, you can't get away from evil. My Bible says in the book of Job that when the sons of God came to church, the devil was there to meet them. Come on, somebody. And this is what Moses' way of saying, Lord, we need you, and we need you right now. And we need you, Lord, to have mercy on us. Lord, we know we haven't kept your commandment. We know we haven't followed your word. We know that we wasted your time. As I get ready to take my seat again, I want to tell somebody in here that while the sun is still shining in your life and on your life, now is the time to say yes to him. Come on, Lord. While the sun is still shining in your life, that's the time to come back to God. When the sun is still shining in your life, that's the time to do the Lord's work. Jesus said in John chapter 9, verse 4, he said, I must work the work of him that sent me while it is still day. But the night, oh, it's come. Mm-hmm. And I just come up with no man shall be able to work. Again, I don't know about anybody else here. That's why the sun is still shining in his life. I'm going to do the Lord's work. I'm going to give the Lord's praise, and I'm going to tell the Lord thank you. I don't know how much time I have, but I'm going to try to make a good use of God's time. So that when the sun does begin to go down, when this body begins to get weak, when God gets ready to call me back home, I want to be able to say, here I am, Lord. I'm now ready to be offered up. The reason, church, I'll be able to say that I'm ready is not because of me, not because of the work that I've done, but because of the work of Jesus Christ. Because of what he did down on Calvary's cross, because he hung, bled, and died, because he went down into a borrowed tomb, because he stayed there Friday and all day Saturday, and because of the fact that he got up early Sunday morning. All power in his hand.